Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. This week I have another interview for you, this time with Mark Sippestein, who is an industrial design drawing instructor at the TU Delft. Sadly, first time around I messed up the audio, but Mark was so kind that he offered to re-record the video again. So thank you very much, Mark. But with that out of the way, let's get started because I think there's a lot of things you guys can take away from this.
Hello, Mark.
Hi.
Welcome to the interview. Thanks. Could you quickly introduce yourself?
Yeah, sure. My name is Mark Sippestein. I'm an instructor in design drawing here at the Delft University of Technology, the Faculty of Industrial Design. I did my studies, my master's here as well. Before that, I was in the same line of work as you are, or were, which is visual communicating, visual thinking stuff. So that's in a nutshell.
All right, thank you very much. Why did you choose the TU Delft for your studies?
I was quite good at maths and things like that in high school. So quickly we came to the conclusion you should do some technical study. And Delft was, to be quite honest, the most close by. I came from Amsterdam, and the other universities are in Twente and Eindhoven, which is a little bit further away. So I started looking in Delft, and first I rolled into mechanical engineering, which is the faculty next door. But that was a little bit too dry for me. I always liked drawing and being creative. So when I came to this faculty for lunch one time, I thought, oh, okay, I should probably switch. And so that's how I ended up at the industrial design here in Delft.
So then your first introduction to industrial design was actually here, accidentally? You
didn't... Yes, it was. Yes, it was. I didn't even know that was a thing. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so it's technically, and then when you were here, what was it that attracted you to, and what was it that you said, okay, oh, you like this?
To be perfectly honest, the sketches. So if you walk down the hallway, you have these framed sketches. Some are quite old school already, but back then, well, they were not that old school. But to somebody who likes drawing but actually didn't know a lot about the theory, they were just mind-blowing. I was like, wow, I wish I could sketch like that, draw like that. So they attracted me to investigate it a bit more. And then I gathered that you can be a little bit, let's say, more creative on the styling side of things, form giving, etc. So that made me switch. Yeah.
Okay. Very good. So other than sketching, you also learn a whole lot of other tools here at the TU Delft. So what would you say is the most important thing or tool that you took away from your studies?
Yeah, that's a difficult one. Well, it's more the approach to things, or the way of thinking, I would say. So you learn to let's say systematically approach a complex problem, and you learn when to be analytical, but also when to be creative. I also think that an important skill or a feature I picked up here is decision making. So being able and confident enough to make a decision, but also realizing that that decision should be tested, evaluated, and realizing in front the kind of uncertainties that you still have to deal with. So basically, the whole approach to dealing with complexity and problem solving is one of the most valuable things I learned here.
Yeah. Very good, very good. And then what did you see yourself becoming after your studies? And then what did you actually become?
Yeah, I had little idea of what I wanted to do until I was quite far late in my studies. And I knew I wanted to do something with drawing, designing, sketching. So I thought about entertainment industry and doing, I don't know, for guerrilla games, computer game design or things like that. But as I rolled along, I learned about this whole visual communication thing. So that's basically sketching for companies who have some sort of innovation trajectory or a creative session, and you are there to visualize the story. So I got into touch with that, and that seemed like a good viable option. And so eventually, after my studies, I ended up in that direction before becoming a teacher here.
Okay, so you used mostly your sketching skills there, as
yeah,
you said.
Yeah.
And then what prompted you to switch from that to teaching?
Well, like I said earlier, I always knew that I liked teaching, that I love to teach, and I love the area of design sketching as well. So in the end, it was the combination of being able to teach, but also to be able to have a little bit more time, or take a little bit more time to develop content, which made me decide to come here. Working for that company I worked for, it was always quite rushed, you know, because your business is just the way business works. So you have to do a lot in as little time as possible, and that makes the quality, at least in my eyes, suffer. And also kind of took away the joy of making a visual. So that was a little bit of the downside. Next to all the upsides that that job had, it was a lot of fun as well. But the combination of those factors made me switch. Yeah.
Okay. And then, since you are a drawing instructor now, can you just quickly take us through the daily tasks of a drawing instructor here at KDL?
Yeah, I can. Basically, it's teaching a lot. So I'm standing in front of a classroom of about 20, 30 students, and I teach them some topic on design sketching. Usually involves the fundamentals for, let's say, the first year's students. You know, perspective, basic light and shading methodology, etc. And later on, materialization, more advanced points of view or perspectives, etc., working with different materials. Apart from that, a lot of preparation and a lot of also innovation of the lessons. So we develop the lessons continuously. We evaluate what went right, what went wrong, why, what should be the new learning objectives, or how should they be amended. So that's a big part of it. And then the rest of my day consists of things like doing a little bit of research on design sketching, and seeing how we can work together with other departments within the faculty, or even university-wide, campus-wide. So yeah, that about feels. And then, of course, there's the grading and all that stuff. Yeah.
The most fun part.
Going through all the drawings, you know. Yeah. Can be a lot of fun, yeah.
So you sort of touched on this one. So let's see if you want to go more into depth. But one of my questions is, because the industry evolves and changes at such a fast pace these days, how do you make sure to be on top of the latest technology and don't teach things that have become obsolete overnight, for example?
Yeah, aside from the tool that you use, it's kind of the methodology and approach that that we teach. So in that sense, even a program like Corel Painter can be used to learn the same kind of methodology, the theory and methodology. So as long as you focus on that, there's not a whole heck of a lot that is completely obsolete, just things that are beneficial. But I do agree that, of course, you have to look at the possibilities that the digital medium offers and see what you can use to, let's say, how do you say it, complete the whole design sketching process, make use of unique features that you don't have at your disposal with just a pen and paper. And indeed, how do we keep on top of that? Well, we do sessions with each other. We learn from experts in the field how they apply those tools in their design sketching field, and we see how we can fit that into the lesson program. Yeah.
Are there still new things coming out in the field that you incorporate into design sketching? Because technically you can teach the same fundamentals from 20, 30 years ago. They won't necessarily change.
No.
But are there new things that you introduce that you noticed in the field that are helpful?
Well, yeah, sometimes you see a new thing coming up. So Photoshop was a new thing at a certain point, and the possibilities it offered. Then you get, for example, the pad, the iPad,
yeah.
Which means that your mobile doesn't change that much for, let's say, the content of the lessons or what you can offer, but it is an innovation, something to keep in mind. Now VR is coming up, so sketching in 3D, what would that implement? We've also been involved in some research on how some AI software could interpret a handmade sketch, which is just done on pen and paper. The AI software could look at it and transfer it into a 3D modeling program, which is not that easy, which is very difficult actually. But we've been involved in doing some research on that, we offering our expertise on the sketching part. So yeah, there's always I suppose things that change that offer innovation possibilities on design and design sketching. VR is mainly what we should be looking in to now, and see how that will evolve.
How do you see the role of sketching now in industrial design in these days with all the digital technology and advancements that we have?
Well, I see it as crucial. Like I said last time as well, I would like to think that you cannot be a designer without being able to sketch. But in all fairness, of course, you could. However, design sketching is a language for the designer, and being able to speak that language well will facilitate the design process on every level, if you ask me. So. We have some people who are able to make beautiful renders and whatever, but you see that before that, when they start analyzing the original problem or brief that they get, when they start creating the initial ideas, they can grab a pen and paper and already externalize their ideas quite proficiently and also in such a way that it's easy to imagine where it could lead to. So being very comfortable with sketching and also the laws of perspective and the fundamentals basically will definitely help you let's say, facilitate the process and then your own thinking process, as well as of course your communication skills. So in that sense, I would say that it's at the core of designing and one of the most valuable skills to have.
Sure. Let me quickly jump to some user questions that I had some followers from Instagram ask me. Is marker rendering still a common thing in the professional design process of a consultancy?
Marker rendering? No. So the use of markers, I think, from the design agencies that we are involved with, is little to none. So they don't use markers. However, they could. If there's power outage, they could use markers, so to say. But still, maybe they are here and there used on a more internal level. So just sketching and maybe grabbing a marker to very quickly, loosely give something a little bit of shade so that you get an idea of the volume. That can happen, but most of the rendering is done digitally. Yeah.
Okay, so would you say that all the marker sketches, the beautifully rendered marker sketches that we see on Instagram or on design site, is that more like an indulgency of the designer? Is it like more they just having fun, you think?
Yes.
I mean, because they still pop up. You still have, like, in these modern days, a whole bunch of traditional marker sketch.
Yeah, and of course, I do have to say that my connections are also limited. So maybe there's design agencies or entrepreneurs out there that still use markers very regularly. What I see in a little bit of larger agencies and companies is that most of the rendering is just done digitally. Doesn't mean that whatever they have practiced back in the day when they were maybe still students with marker doesn't apply. So you still see the same techniques. And to be honest, a lot could be done with marker. You know, you could make a very nice marker rendering and present that to a client. It's just that the computer offers more flexibility.
Yeah.
So in a practical sense, when it comes to that stage, it's maybe a little bit safer for time management to do it digitally. But I think most of the designers still like to see traditional marker work and maybe also do that in their free time. Yeah, sure, why not?
Fair enough. If somebody wants to become an industrial designer but doesn't know what it exactly entails,
yeah,
what would you tell them? What is industrial design, or what is the one thing that that is really the core of it?
That is really at the core of it. That's a difficult question. It would be something like adding value through innovation. We also here have the slogan "Design for the future." So basically, you try to make the world a little bit of a better place, and you do that through analyzing the world. And seeing where things are not optimal or maybe even bad. And as a designer, you learn how to define such a problem and from there work into a solution. And through that, eventually try to make the world a little bit of a better place, I suppose.
Yeah, that's a very good pitch. I like it.
Yeah. You should maybe I should add that nowadays, industrial design, at least here, but I think in most universities, it's not only about product design anymore. So you can be a service designer, a strategist, whatever. That's also perfectly possible to use design on such a level to of course, make the world a better place.
Based on that, I just got a question on one of my YouTube videos. Somebody asked me, can you tell me what's the difference between product design and industrial design?
Yeah, I think mainly that well, from what I understand, it started out as the same. So I don't know, this faculty is celebrating its 50th anniversary today or this year, and it started out as product design. So coming from mechanical engineering, aimed to design products that function well, but also look well and are very clear in their use as well. But of course, since then we've grown into a whole different society where you have more surface design as well, and the product is sometimes not the most relevant thing to design. It's maybe the surface behind it, or the whole strategy behind it. So nowadays, product design is just a branch of industrial design, where industrial design is maybe a little bit of a broader scope in that sense.
So you would say industrial design is sort of the umbrella term, and then product design is one of its under branches?
That's how I would see it. Yeah, at this point.
Okay, which is also interesting for me. The term product design almost like got a new definition in the last couple of years, because we have so much digital products that it seems whenever product design pops up, people start thinking only of digital products lately.
Yeah, that's true. And, well, I think product design should and will always be there. I mean, in the end, things need to have some sort of physical manifestation, at least, you know, the microphone, the laptop, whatever. But of course, and that's not the only thing anymore. So the whole way it's connected to the rest of the products and developing smart systems, complex systems, that is also part of it. So a product is never, almost never, just on its own anymore. And that is something that has changed.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's a very good point. And then stepping a little bit away, now that we go towards the end, stepping a little bit away from industrial design, you're also a fine artist. Can you tell us more about how you got into that?
Well, it's mainly just a hobby of mine. How I got into that. Like I said, I always liked drawing. And then with the rise of the internet and all the media, I saw also a lot of fine artists, also in musea, of course, and I got curious, how do you do that, you know? So I took a sort of sidestep into that and found out how to work with charcoal and oil paints, focusing on quite traditional ways to make a portrait and figurative art. So I love that so much that that is how I relax in my spare time.
Very nice. Yeah. And how do you go from digital, especially these days where it's so easy and you see so many digital artists like really painting digitally, and you still decided to take the step, no, I'm not going to do it digitally, I'm going to go all the way back to traditional painting, namely using oil?
Yeah, indeed. I already forgot again, but that's a good point, because I tried to start out digitally. So, Jesus, I don't know, about 10 years back or something, I think I got my first Wacom tablet. I was quite proficient, relatively, of course, in line sketching, using lines to draw, to make a drawing. What I lacked was a good sense of color, how to apply colors. So suppose you draw a cool superhero or a cool car, and the line drawing is there, and you're proud of it, and now you have to give it some colors. And I always seem to fail with that. I learned by then, was the beginning of my studies, how to use marker a bit, so I tried some with that. But I got a tablet, Wacom Intuos 4 tablet. And I had some version of Photoshop, so I thought, okay, this is going to be awesome. I'm going to scan my line drawings and take it into Photoshop. I have millions of colors at my disposal. What can possibly go wrong, you know? So it was a little bit overwhelming. It was very fun. I still do some digital drawing and concept art as well in my free time. But I quickly found that to learn colors, and also to make the kind of art that I admired, the traditional things that I saw, there was no real use in trying to do that through a digital medium. So I decided to go back and to use just a few colors, just a few brushes, literal brushes, you know, And with that kind of limited workspace, it was much easier to learn and to practice. Otherwise, I got lost in the layer modes and filters and whatever all Photoshop offers. And I can definitely say that because I went back to traditional and then learned to paint in oils, at least somewhat, I definitely also got me better in making digital art.
Yeah,
it's funny, but that's the way it works.
Nice. And you do a lot of figure painting, figure studies also with charcoal. Drawing and studying the figure, does that return anything to industrial design as well? Do you take something away from that you can use in industrial design as well?
Yeah, well, I think drawing the figure is kind of overlooked in industrial design, which is a shame. I'm not saying that you have to do the kind of artistic charcoal renderings of human figures that maybe you will show them in cue drawing that I do in my spare time, but yes, having an understanding of the human figure would allow you to quickly draw some human figure in a certain position or pose along with the product or surface that you are designing. Because whatever you design, you usually design it for people.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes maybe for animals, but most of the time for people, of course. So what you see here is that sometimes people can draw beautiful products, but they cannot really communicate through sketching the kind of interaction that they propose or the kind of experience that the user has with it, and that is overlooked, and that is often a shame. So I think it would be very valuable for a designer, an industrial designer, to have some skill in drawing a human figure, because as soon as you put that along with your design, it adds so much more information, so much more value to your communication.
And now that we're ending the nearing the end,
okay,
a couple of questions from my Instagram followers.
Sure.
One question is, how do you manage time? And just to nail to hammer it down a little bit, I would say balance of work and improving your drawing. So when you're a student or when you want to switch to industrial design, when you have a full time commitment during the day and then you still want to get better at drawing.
And then other things have to suffer, I suppose. I mean, there's a lot of online resources, so you can get a long way from your home. There's also a lot of online schools, of course, to which you can subscribe and follow classes whenever it suits you. But you have to get the time from somewhere, especially if you have a full-time job. I have a full-time job, regular job here. Which works well for me. So whenever I get home, I can leave all the work stuff here, and I just have my own free time, and I can do with it whatever I want. I don't have children yet. Maybe that could change some time priorities. But yeah, there's times when I just sit at home and I sketch. Or paint or whatever, or I read a book about drawing and painting, whatever. It just has my interest, so that is how I spend my free time, which means that sometimes I don't go get a beer with my friends or go partying, which I'm a little bit too old for anyway nowadays. So that's basically it. It's taking or thinking to yourself, what has priority with the precious free time that I have? What do I want to spend it on in the first place? Yeah.
Okay. And then one last question, so we don't make this interview too long. Why not concept art instead of industrial design? Because you did mention that you like concept art and do it in your free time.
Yeah. I like it, and I looked into an internship at Guerrilla Games. And I studied a bit about what it takes to be a concept artist, and it's kind of just the way it went. So I kind of was a freelance illustrator during my studies, and through that path I came into the whole visual communication agency. On the other hand, I also started realizing that, especially as a junior concept artist, it's at least to my understanding, it's quite the grind. So you have to, once again, it's a business, so you have to be able to just pump out a lot of visuals in a very short time. Doesn't mean you do not get to be creative, but they told me that it's quite demanding. So I'm notoriously lazy. So I thought to myself, okay, maybe I'll consider it or reconsider my options. And then that other option came along, visual communication. So that was the nice way to go. Just also convenient, because I already had some experience in that. And yeah, when a job opening entered here, I returned to industrial design in that sense. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. And then the final question is, would you like to plug something here from the TU Delft? Last time you mentioned also something about online tools or a platform that you are building.
Yeah, indeed we are building here with the drawing staff, where we have begun a special interest group on design sketching, which means that we partner with universities from over the world, and we try to bring research and education and industrial design practice together. So it's a nice platform on which you can see the latest of the latest happening in design sketching, and also the research into design and design sketching. I will send you the link with the SIG and the Instagram for that. And of course, you can check out our website, delftdesigndrawing.com, to see or get a glimpse of the kind of stuff that we teach here. That's basically it. Yeah, sure.
All right. Yeah. Thank you very much, Mark.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
All right. That was it for this week's interview. Thank you again for Mark for his time. I really hope you guys liked it. If you did, please feel free to leave me a comment or question. Also hit that like button and subscribe if you would like to see more content like this. There will be also further drawing videos upcoming, and you can also follow me on Instagram if you'd like to see more sketches there. Anyways, hope you enjoyed. Wish you guys a great week and see you next time. Bye-bye.